History rises like the sun over the land of Lanka, dispelling the darkness of myth and legend. On the full moon day in the month of Pusam, in the year 247 BC, when there appeared on a rock in the north central region of the island, Arahat Mahinda, bringing with him the gentle doctrine of Gautama the Buddha. Within a century, a great civilization was born and flourished in the fertile valley of the Malvatuoya, with its center in a city called Anuradhapura. Under the symbolic shade of the Sri Mahabodhi, a branch of the Bo tree in Buddhagaya, where Buddha attained enlightenment and brought to Sri Lanka within a few years after the arrival of Arahat Mahinda by his own sister, Sanghamitta, a close link was forged between state and the Buddhism. There developed a lifestyle perhaps unique in the ancient world. The forest-capped mountains rise from cultivated valleys whose green crops watered by artificial lakes that set at naught the periodical droughts to which the northern provinces are subject. This fertility was not merely for physical subsistence, but fed the spiritual life of the vast masses, sustained their dreams and maintained a faith reflected in the awesome religious monuments. Ruwan Valley, or the Gold Dust Agama, built in the 2nd century BC to mark the birth of a nation, when King Dutukamanu, hero of the epic Mahavamsa, born of the legendary princess Vihara Mahadevi of the western region, sired by a king of the deep south, united the three regions under one scepter. It is one of the most beautiful monuments to a faith in the world. To the north of the sacred city of Anuradhapura stand Abhayagiri, one of the most important centers of Buddhist academia in the ancient world. It is recorded in chronicles that Abhayagiri was built by King Vattagamini Abhaya, popularly known as Valakamba, somewhere between 89 and 77 BC. Covering approximately 200 hectares, Abhayagiri Vihara had all the components required by doctrine for a Buddhist temple: the image house, stupa, Bo tree, shrine or Bodhighara, chapter house or Poyage, residence for monks, and refectories. However, this complex grew over 5 centuries and reached its zenith in the 7th century AD. The centerpiece of the monastery Abhayagiri Stupa, as it stands today, is the original as last renovated by Parakramabahu I, sometime in the 12th century AD. This is Jethavana, a stupa at the center of a monastic complex which stood in direct rivalry to the Abhayagiri. Built by King Mahasena, who ruled at Anuradhapura between 276 to 303 AD, the gigantic stupa, which is the focal point of the monastery complex, was the third tallest monument in the world at the time of the collapse of the Roman Empire in the 4th century AD. it was surpassed only by the two tallest pyramids at Gizeh. At over 120 meters in height, it is the tallest stupa in the world, and indeed the tallest brick building ever built by man. In the words of the British civil servant Sir Emerson Tennant, who gazed upon it in awe, the materials are sufficient to raise 8,000 houses, 30 streets half a mile in length, would construct a town the size of Ipswich or Coventry. They would line an ordinary railway tunnel 20 miles long or form a wall 1 foot in thickness and 10 feet in height, reaching from London to Edinburgh. This deceptively simple monolithic Buddha statue in the Samadhi or contemplative pose is now considered a masterpiece of Buddhist art. Its classical simplicity and purity of line and form have invested it with a translucent spiritual quality, reflecting the Spartan code of Theravada Buddhism. It dates back to the 4th century AD and is referred to by the Chinese traveler Fa Hien. That the monastery complex at Jethavana housed nearly 3,000 monks at a time, going by the size of the refectory. The site, covering approximately 80 hectares and set out as a monastery, contains all the elements of a highly evolved monastic architecture. Scattered around the site are many residential complexes or colleges, integrated into a well-planned theological academy. Of the refectories or alms halls at both Abhayagiri and Jethavana are clear indications of the large number of residential students, scholars and other members of these monasteries, which may have been anything from 4,000 to 5,000 at any given time. This Pilimage or image house, 27 feet in height, had once upon a time contained an upright figure of the Buddha. Only the base remains today, with its chamber stripped of all the precious offerings buried before erecting the statue. Thank you. This is the Uposathagara or chapter house of the Jetavana complex, residential quarters for monks known as Panchavasa. An inscription of King Mahinda IV, dated somewhere towards the end of the 10th century, speaks thus. Whatever remains after repairs have been effected at the site of the great stone statue, Ruanpaha, the chapter house at the Abeyatura Mahasaya, at the shrine of the sacred Bo tree, shall be kept as communal property. Recent archaeological excavations at the site have also revealed other features such as assembly halls and temple buildings. At the entrance to the residential quarters of the chief priest is a guard stone. S.M. Burrows, in his archaeological report in the late 19th century, states, the door guardian stones, standing over 5 feet high, is unrivaled in excellence of preservation and delicacy of finish. This is the best example of a moonstone, a creation unique to Sri Lankan sculpture. It can be seen at the foot of the steps leading to the Panchavasa or the monk's quarters. This is a kind of stupa rare in Sri Lanka, with steps leading to the upper stories, and reflects strong and mystic Mahayanic influences. There is evidence supported by finds that the entire stupa, stone slabs and statues, have all been painted with locally produced lime-based paint. One such paint-making center with engraved depressions for mixing has been discovered and restored at Abhayagiri. The Sannipata Sala or assembly hall for monks facing the Abhayagiri Dagaba is the largest of its kind in Anuradhapura and may have accommodated a congregation of over 5,000. In the Mahamega Gardens, there are the remains of a sanatorium for aging bhikkhus. Dharani Griha, as these terraced edifices are known, may have been chambers where rituals and occult practices were performed and reflect the Mahayanic tradition represented by the Abhayagiri chapter. Abhisheka Mandapa, the ceremonial anointing hall. There is something very weird about these remnants of ancient luxury hidden in the lonely forest, observed Henry W. Cave, writing in 1896. There are so many, he continued, and they vary so much in architectural treatment that they must have added greatly to the aspect of the city. We cannot help reflecting, too, that the famous baths of the Roman emperors were constructed contemporaneously with these, and that while those of Caracalla and Diocletian, being built of brick, have crumbled now beyond repair, the picturesque and elegant baths of Duttagamini and their beautiful terraces and stairways of granite can with little trouble be restored to their pristine condition. Cave was unaware that these elegant baths were built almost exclusively for the use of Buddhist monks in a city wholly dedicated to a faith whose goal is nirvana. There are other stupas in the Abhayagiri Vihara complex. One such is the Lankarama stupa, which originally had a conical roof covering. The community of monks had enormously increased with the popularity of the new religion, and Duttagamini made their welfare his chiefest care, erecting the Loha Pasada, known as the Brazen Palace, for their accommodation. In the words of the great chronicle Mahavamsa, in this palace there were 1,000 dormitories, having windows with ornaments which are bright as eyes. Ruanvelisaya, the gold dust dagaba with its purity of line and contours of classical spareness, symbolizes the spirit of Anuradhapura, one of the most beautiful chapters in the history of mankind's quest for peace and harmony on earth. To the southeast of Anuradhapura is this hill rising from a range bursting out of the plain from practically sea level. Ritigala Kanda, the rock like a long pole, is steeped in history and legend. Once upon a time, the abode of the Yakkas, indigenous tribals of prehistoric Lanka, Ritigala enters recorded history in 311 BC, still not totally free of myth, when Mahavamsa records a great battle here between the rebel prince Pandukabha and his uncles. 1,000 years later, Ritigala becomes a hermitage for an order of bhikkhus, referred to as Pansakulika, who had taken a vow of extreme asceticism. It received royal patronage, and the numerous ruins which litter the entire hill range and its many once inhabited caves afford ample support to the story of the ancient importance of the site. Ritigala lay wrapped in a taboo that no mortal should step within its dark and mysterious precincts, because the spirits of the now vanished Yakka tribe protected their ancestral abode from intruders. James Mantle, a British surveyor, broke the taboo and entered Ritigala somewhere between 11th of May and 10th of July 1872. For the British civil servants of the 19th century, stationed in the harsh and unhealthy climate of the north central province of Sri Lanka, Ritigala offered the tantalizing promise of a sanctuary. Within a few hours, one gets away from the hot and sultry plains to pure and invigorating air with heavy mists, even in the hottest time of the year. The Tank civilization and the agrarian economy of ancient Sri Lanka reaches its most glorious phase in the 12th century at Polonnaruwa. Strategically located on a crossing of the river Mahaveli in the great divide between the North Central Plains and the Southern region, Polonnaruwa was the second and the last great capital of the Mahavamsa kings. However, Polonnaruwa's place in history was mainly due to Parakramabahu the Great, in whose reign of 42 years, the city very nearly surpassed its predecessor in splendor and fame. As these reconstructed models show, Polonnaruwa is more secular than Anuradhapura, more urbane and sensuous. Moreover, as the ruins are not so ruined, they require less effort of imagination to enable one to recast scenes of the past. Polonnaruwa dominates in weather-worn brick as against the purer rock creations of Anuradhapura. There is a decadent stucco ornamentation which whispers of imitation. Three centuries before Polonnaruwa was built, the hand of the Pandyan and Chola invader was strong in Sri Lanka. This, no doubt, is one reason why the style and architecture of Polonnaruwa is predominantly Hindu in type. As the classical contours of gracefully sculptured granite give way to brick, one sees Tamil norms of architecture dominate in buildings which are devoted to Buddhist religious concepts. Parakrama himself was a Brahmin and chiefly of Tamil blood, as doubtless were his court and nobility. The royal architect of Polonnaruwa may have realized that he had to conciliate two sections of supporters and could not afford to alienate the Sinhalese and the Buddhist monks. As the Sinhala kingdom began withdrawing to the central hills, in the great historical shift known as the drift to the southwest, the jungle tide crept over Pulathinagara, as Polonnaruwa was referred to in the ancient chronicles. By the beginning of the 19th century, it had become a malaria-infested marginal settlement known as Thopari. One day, in the year 1828, a young first lieutenant of His Majesty's 2nd Ceylon Regiment, marching his detachment from Batiklo in the east coast to the interior, was attracted by some stone pillars standing in the jungle, off the road, and decided to examine. It was he, Lieutenant M.H. Fagan, who stumbled upon the ruins of Polonnaruwa after five centuries of oblivion. What is reconstructed here is what Fagan may have imagined Polonnaruwa to have been in its days of glory. His carefully compiled notes, first published in the Ceylon Government Gazette of August 1, 1820, and reprinted in 1885 in Volume 2 of The Orientalist, written with a gift for vividly painting a picture in words, are a pioneer account of the discovery of the disintegrating remains of Pulathinagara, consigned to oblivion under a forest of large trees, five centuries old, and covered by a mantle of lush undergrowth. Thank you. The elegant baths of the Anuradhapura culture are repeated here with one difference. These are made of brick. This exquisite bath is, however, an exception. Paved with granite in the form of a lotus, this pond reflects the ornate and the sensuous nature of Pulanaruwa art. These murals in the Thivanka Shrine Room are the earliest examples of Buddhist temple paintings in Sri Lanka, a tradition which is one of the key strands in the fabric of Sinhala culture. Hindu shrines have entered the courtyard and the prescribed sacred precincts of the Buddhist temple. Nandi, the sacred Hindu bull, sits on its haunches. Fagan, in the afternoon of that day of discovery, beheld the monolithic carvings in heroic size at Galvihara. The evening was closing fast, he wrote, when I found myself under a dark and gigantic human figure, at least 25 feet high. I cannot describe what I felt at the moment. On examination, I found this to be a figure of Budhu. To the Philistine, who remains unmoved by the story of these pallid stones bleached by centuries of sun and rain, wrote R.L. Brohier. To him who visits this historical skeleton and fails to be lulled by the harmony of its art, the delicacy of its carvings, I have but one word of advice. Do not desecrate antiquity. Keep away. Rising 200 meters abruptly from the surrounding plain, lying between Anuradhapura and Pulanaruwa, Sigiriya, or the Lion Rock, at first seems a geological phenomenon. Today it is a monument to a crime and a treasure house of rare art all in one, with the spirit of once upon a time hovering over it. Sigiriya comes dramatically, if tragically, into the political history of Sri Lanka in the last quarter of the 5th century, when Prince Kashyapa slew his father Dhatusena and withdrew into this rock, turning it into a palace in the sky, reminiscent of the mythical splendor of ancient Babylon. from the pleasure gardens below, laid out with mathematical precision. The way up is tier by tier from terrace to terrace until a plateau is reached with chambers, buildings and pavilions. Built up from the base of the rock itself with brick masonry, this wall has a highly polished plaster finish from which it gets its ancient name, Katapat Paura or the Mirror Wall. On this polished surface, generations of visitors inscribe their thoughts and feelings in verse. Here begins the land staircase, one of Sigiriya's most dramatic features. Tootsal paws are all that remains of a gigantic lion face made out of brick and plaster, which would have gazed northwards once upon a time. The royal palace at the summit of Sigiriya lies about 180 meters above the surrounding plain and 360 meters above mean sea level. It is not only the loftiest and innermost precinct of the Sigiriya complex, but also the geometrical center on which the plan of Sigiriya is based. Most poems on the mirror wall at Sigiri are about these lovely damsels on a series of frescoes done in a depression on the rock. These are surviving fragments of an immense backdrop of paintings that once extended in a wide band across the western face of the rock. The Sinhalese from their ancestral homeland in the north central plains, in the great drift to the southwest across history, came to an end in Kandy, the last independent stronghold of the Sinhala kings. The tooth relic of the Buddha, first brought to Sri Lanka during the Anuradhapura period by a prince and princess from Kalinga, had by now become the palladium of royal power. And wherever the king resided, there was built a temple of the tooth. Thus, the sacred tooth came to reside in Kandy, when in the 17th century, Vimala Dharmasurya declared himself king of the central kingdom of Kandaudarata. Here it resides still in the temple, first built by Vimala Dharmasurya, and developed and extended by his successors up to the first decade of the 19th century. In Kandy, unlike in the earlier historical cities, history flows uninterrupted from the past into the present. South Indian influence, first appearing in Polonnaruwa in the 11th century, has been assimilated over the centuries. There is a seamless fusion here between the ornate Hindu motifs and the classical contours of Theravada Buddhism. Thank you. In Kandy, where past meets the present, there's to be found a fine synthesis of all the socio-cultural strands that flow through 2,500 years of Sri Lankan history.